This is Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. Hi, Jennifer.
Hi, Richard.
How are you? Wow, it's been a whole week since I saw you last, and what fun.
It has been.
Tell us what you've been up to. What have you been doing? Please.
I have been working with people, working on projects, which has been interesting. It's very funny, actually. They're trying to push me into the, they're not pushing me. There's something scripted and something non-scripted that I'm working on right now.
Wow. So what you're telling us is that you may be gone. We might not be able to get you. You'll be on a set somewhere.
I will still make you miserable for the rest of your life, Richard. Okay. Away.
All right, we like that. All right, very good.
They could embellish it. Like if they do a scripted show, who's going to play Richard?
Yeah, that's they'll get somebody, you know, a much cooler Richard.
But so this week there's been, and I know we talked about how healing it was when I went to Mexico. And I worked with somebody actually this week that also helped. And, you know, I am like the reason why we didn't meet earlier today was because my mom, we're selling her house and we put it up on the market. And one day we got two offers that were above whatever. I know, one of those crazy things. And I was to sign escrow papers today. And I'm like, so there's a lot of things going on that my heart feels better though. Like, I don't think I would have been able to handle it if I hadn't done all the work, I guess, healing wise.
Yeah, all that healing.
It's ongoing, which is going to be ongoing. But it today could have looked a lot differently. It could have looked a lot different. Sorry.
No, and you know, it's interesting because there are so many people who they get their statue of Joseph and they bury him in the ground. You know, have you heard about this? This is like, this is an old Catholic thing where you take a statue of Joseph, you know, Jesus' stepfather, and you bury it upside down in your yard and it helps you to sell your house. And I must say, my parents' house in Chicago, which was on the market for about, I don't know, 3-6 months, something crazy, and not even a nibble. And then somebody reminded me of this. And so we did that, you know, and it was sold the next day, whatever, you know. Who knows?
I thought you were talking about Joseph Smith. Well, now they're putting him upside down.
No, that's another Joseph. I don't think that dude was a carpenter. But this little fella, that's the statue that you're supposed to.
Kind of looks like Joseph Smith.
Bury in the backyard. Oh, really?
He's holding the golden plates.
Yes, I know. I don't, the golden plate. That's funny. The golden chef. Okay, so here we are. Speaking on our podcast, and for those tuning in for the first time or the last time,
I did have something very interesting happen with my last client, which she said it was okay for me to say this.
Oh, please do.
She listens to our podcast, and she was super funny. Her dad was a judge. Her name's Sarah, and she asked if one of her pets came back as a cat. One of her dogs came back. I'm like, I didn't know that they could do that or whatever, but I wanted to mention this because it was so funny and interesting to me. And I'm like, yeah, you definitely have one of your dogs came back as a cat. And I'm like, I've never heard that before because I didn't know, you know, I always thought there, but we've heard Hyra being a horse.
Sure. And it's a wishful thinking for a lot of them.
They're reminding me. So what I was being shown was, you know, spirit manipulates like animals to go by their loved ones. And so, and they tell us where to look, you know? So when it happens, like we think it's just, oh, a butterfly went by. They'd spent a lot of work making sure they merged their energy into the butterfly to make the butterfly go a certain way. They don't become the butterfly, but they kind of merge their energy. And then they merge with us saying, hey, look at the butterfly. And so I'm like, well, I guess they can merge, like a cat or a dog could be, you know, I haven't seen a human become a dog. I haven't seen that, but I did. So it was so funny. And then the dog came through saying, "I hated the smell of dogs. I was such a diva. I'm so happy to be a cat now." Like, being, and everything lined up. She just laughed. I mean, it was just so
Hysterical things that a cat would say if it was reincarnated from being a dog.
funny. Like,
Very funny. Well, we have, you know, you and I have done this kind of unusual exploration of talking to animals on the flip side, including Hira, Robert Towne's dog, the guy who wrote Chinatown. Hira was his commodore, and he used to come. I used to walk him for 3 years. So when he talks about things that he's aware of, I'm aware of them as well. But Hira have introduced the topic to us that animals understand how incarnation works, including reincarnation, but humans do not. And so we've heard Hira talk about a previous lifetime as a horse, which he gave us a town and a place and a name, all of which I was startled to find in Scotland, you know, and the name of a manor and the name of a town. It was like, what? But
That's great.
that topic's come up again and again and again. And so the animals that we've spoken to, and then also in the guided meditations that I've done with people, sometimes they'll see an animal on the flip side. A
And
lot of
but
times, go ahead.
where can someone get a guided meditation from you?
Oh, please just send me an email to Martini Prods, MartiniProds at gmail.com, and I'll set something up for you. Why not?
Out there.
Yeah, and you know, it's about an hour, really. And what I do is I've kind of honed this idea of doing a guided meditation. Picture yourself in a boat on a river, and give people an example of doing. Have we ever done that?
You and I,
Yeah.
we did a waterfall when my dad passed.
So, I don't know. What do you think?
We could do that.
We could do that. All right. But you know what? Luana is our moderator on the flip side. Now, somebody told me that Luana said something to them. Now, this is somebody else talking to someone on the flip side. And they said, oh, Luana told me to tell you this. Now, I'd like to ask Lou if that was accurate.
It wasn't accurate. It was interpretation, but she did talk to that person.
Very good. Thank you. I mean, if I said the names of the people, this is a very famous person who has passed away, who came forward to talk to somebody that I know who's very adept at this and said, oh, Luana wanted to let you know that she's like busy doing something else now and not so involved. Anyway, and so what you're saying is that that interpretation was not correct on the part of the person who said it.
Let me look again. Hold on. I want to make sure my interpretation of the interpretation was correct.
Okay.
One. It wasn't the right interpretation. It was partially right, but
Partially right.
she's working harder with this project. She's not, it's so she got her working
I
and she's
see.
working somewhere else, but she's actually. She says she's working more with everything that we've created together. Like,
Okay, that makes sense. I mean, I think he was trying, he was this person on the other side was saying, you know, she's taking on these other responsibilities, so like I'm available to talk is kind of what they were saying.
oh, interesting. Hold on. That's true, she says, but it's just because she's doing more work and but she's doing more of what we're doing.
All
On
right,
the other.
so Lou, you know what's going on in our world, in Jennifer's world, in my world. Who is it you want to bring to our podcast today? And this is our, for people tuning in for the first or last time, this is Luana Anders, actress, her friend.
Oh, she said thank you so much for all the birthday wishes for all
Oh,
the love.
yeah, her birthday was on May 12th. Okay, you know what? There's a couple of people that are close friend of yours that have just crossed over. Are either one of them, there's a man and a woman, are either one of them ready to come forward and talk to us?
One of them is the man.
Okay, the man. Very good.
I don't know who the man is.
I
No
do.
idea.
And Jennifer, do you want to give Jennifer the first name of this person or an image?
my gosh, I'm not gonna know. Hold on. This isn't working. Give me a second. Is it a conductor or something, or somebody that's a director?
Director, correct. I'll give you his first name. How's that?
Sure.
Roger.
Okay. I would not have gotten that.
You would not have gotten it. Yeah, well, I think of all the famous Rogers that are out there. Jolly Roger. Sorry?
Is that you doing that?
You mean the sound of what?
Oh, that's so cool. It felt like it sounded like something that, like a bowl of some sort.
Like a
Okay.
what? Like a
Yeah.
bowl?
I said he was in your dream. Like he's already come to you.
Okay. Well, let's if Roger's ready to talk to us, please come on forward and let's have a
I
chat,
mean,
Roger.
is it you don't sleep well?
Well, you know, I do. I must say there are.
Did you have a chest cold or anything, or did you have allergies last week?
Last week, yeah, we did. We had the carpet was torn up, and we had a lot of dust in the apartment. So, Roger, let's talk to you a little bit about your journey. Now, how did you know Luana? Do you want to show Jennifer, or Luana? Do you want to show Jennifer? How did these guys know each other?
I don't know if he was a mentor of hers or if they like he loved her. Like he's just showing me how he loved her, but she was younger. Like
That's correct.
she was younger, and so he didn't cross that line or whatever.
No, they were, yeah, he was a mentor and he was a producer. He produced movies.
And he said that any role that he like every role he wanted for her. That's what it feels like.
Well, they did three movies together, I think. And was one of Luana had done a few movies, you know, before, and
Was
then.
the last, but did he want her for a movie when she got sick? Like she started getting sick?
We talked. Oh, yes, that's correct. She wrote a movie for him. It's a movie called Fire on the Amazon. And Luana wrote it for Roger, but she used a pseudonym because Roger at the time wasn't using Writers Guild writers. And they were old friends. And so he came to her and he was like, you know, how can I help you? And she said, well, hire me, you know, to write something. And he paid her to write. And Sandra Bullock starred in that film.
Oh, that's so
So,
interesting.
Roger, one of your students is in Cannes tonight. Somebody that you worked with is in the Cannes Film Festival and being celebrated, honored today. Do you want to show Jennifer who that is?
I don't know. It's not Tom Cruise. Who is it?
Well, if he doesn't want to show you, he can show you.
I don't know. I don't know because it just, that's just what popped my
Tom
head.
showed up. That's funny.
Give me
His
a
name,
second.
his, go ahead.
Do I even know the actor, or do I even know who he
No,
is?
this is a movie director. So Roger was a film producer and he started the careers of a lot of people.
Yeah.
And Luana did three movies for him.
Right.
And the guy who's being celebrated in Cannes tonight, Francis Coppola.
Coppola.
There you go.
Wouldn't have gotten that.
Francis.
Sorry.
Okay, but Francis is being celebrated tonight, and Francis was a sound man on a movie called The Young Racers that Roger produced, and then he directed his first movie, which Luana had a main role in, called Dementia 13.
Wow.
So, Roger, who greeted you on the other side?
He said Francis has waited so long for this. It's well deserved. Well deserved. He's like, they have to give it to him before he gets up here.
Well, this movie that he's just finished, he spent a long time working on. And, you know, it might even be 30 years, but go ahead.
Has 15 years. Really
15
good.
years. Well, I think that's probably actively. And he financed the movie out of his own pocket, and it's being celebrated in Cannes tonight. But so Roger, go ahead. Who greeted you when you crossed over? Who was there?
I feel like it was his wife that greeted him.
It could be her higher self. Is that what he's saying?
First wife or first girlfriend? I don't know. Hold on. It was brief. Hold on.
So, what was that like for you, Roger? Was that
And he said then Luana and everybody else, like the floodgates opened with everybody else. He said it was just, it was a, he's like, as it was as if it was as if I was Justin Bieber. Like,
Being
you just felt
celebrated on the flip side.
like walking through something and having all these friends and everyone he's ever loved coming up and bump, like rushing up to him. He said that's what it felt like. That's what he could imagine what it's like to be a hot guy and all, you know,
Right.
stunned.
A celebrity. Well, Jennifer, do you have any idea who I'm talking about?
Oh no, I have no idea, babe.
Okay, his last name is Corman, and Roger Corman, who, you know, for people who live in the industry.
This is my scribble writing. So
That's a
Roger,
scopla. There
that's
you go.
all I have is like Roger and then scribble writing with something I'm left. Corman, K or C?
Corman. And I met with Roger and Fred Roos. We had lunch with them a couple of years ago. A couple of things happened. One was we talked about Luana's credit on the movie Fire on the Amazon, and how she had taken a pseudonym. And after that conversation, he put her name on the film, which was very nice of him, so that people would know that she wrote that. But the other thing was, Luana wrote a screenplay about, you know, her growing up in Hollywood and, you know, the acting class.
He showed me with her looking like in the 60s with the short skirt, like the not the short skirt, but the whatever. Yeah, he showed me her
Right,
stuff.
young ingenue, blonde hair, way
Yeah.
before I met her. You know, and so she had written a wonderful screenplay because Roger was the guy who came to that acting class, and out of that acting class pulled Jack Nicholson, Sally Kellerman, all these other people, Luana, eventually Dennis Hopper, all these people to be part of his network of, you know, and he made a lot of B movies, they call them.
He made all of them. He said they, but the way he is the way that I'm getting his interpretation. He's like, I didn't make them, they made themselves. I gave them the avenue.
Yes. And so Rance Howard, who we've talked to, that's Ron Howard's dad. Go ahead.
He's like, in Dennis Hopper, that was a lot. And he's
Yeah, that was he was a little bit more to handle back in those days. But anyway, this is like movie history 101. But I just wanted to see if Roger had been greeted. And what was that like for you when you crossed over? Was that what you expected, or was that?
troubling, he says. It was troubling. Hold on. Just a matter of fact, it was troubling because I was dead.
Troubling, I see. And then, but it's at some point, not so much. And when did that happen?
When he felt all the love that was coming for him, so much love and gratitude. Like, I was grateful for my life. It felt easy. Easier than most people had. I had my struggles with my own family and other things, but he said he learned a lot about heartache here. I also learned a lot about love. I also learned a lot about, I don't know why he showed me, I don't know that he was showing me something. I don't know who's showing me John Travolta, but not about love, but just about I think what you go through when you have loss, like John Travolta's had loss, so I
Yeah,
must.
that's right. He's lost his wife and his son.
I just didn't know how great it was to be alive, even though I was grateful for it.
So, if you could tell your onstage self something, you know, the way we want people to hear, what would it be? You're laughing.
He's like, just shut the fuck up and just do it. Like, stop complaining, stop whining, stop this, stop that. If you're alive, you have a great life. You can make it whatever it is that you want. You can either focus on the bad or you can focus on the good. And too many people focus on what's not going right versus on what is right. And if you focus on what is right, more right will come to you.
Is there anyone you were surprised to see on the flip side?
Ira.
Robert's dog. Well, Robert wrote movies for him as well, because Roger was in this class. You wouldn't know that, but Robert Tom was in, and he was before Robert had
I'm
Hiram.
talking, I'm just opening up my blinds. So,
All right, go
Robert.
ahead. But Robert was a non-actor in an acting class. So he's there with Jack Nicholson.
Oh, he
And
was.
oh yeah, and Robert was there like taking notes on everybody and what they were doing. And of course that's what made him a better screenwriter because he was watching what they did. And so one of Roger's first movies, some of the movies, one of them's called The Last Woman on Earth, and Robert wrote it and stars in it as a guy named Edward Wayne. So it's just a three character movie that they shot in Puerto Rico in the 60s. And anyway, and Roger directed some of the movies. I watched a movie recently that he directed called The Pit and the Pendulum, and they did like a 35 millimeter print, brand new at the Academy. And it was like as if it had been shot yesterday. And there was Luana as a young star in that film with Vincent Price. I mean, it was fantastic the way it looked, and I don't know, it was very moving to see.
So what he's also, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, go ahead, please.
He's laughing. He goes, "You're saying that you interrupt?" Okay, maybe he lives it. Go ahead. Oh, seeing all the sync, thank you. Seeing all the synchronicities that it takes for you to meet him, for the wanted to be in the class, for that whole class to be there. And then the extension, you show me like the six, what we say, the six of
Degrees of
Kevin.
Kevin Bacon, yeah.
He's like, it's the 6 degrees of that class and what it did for everyone that it extended to. Sorry, he's talking about Jack Nicholson. He's like, is Jack around here yet?
No, Jack's still on the planet. Having fun. I think one of his sons was just his grandson, Duke, was just cast in a big movie. Duke Nicholson. I was going to ask Roger about, oh, this is a weird thing. I didn't mention this to you, Roger, when I had lunch with you. And this is what's so fun about working with Jennifer. You can remind people of things you forgot to say. But there were two young cinematographers that I sent to your organization. I was having dinner with them,
Is there
and
anything about Europe or from Europe or the same
yeah,
thing?
that's correct. They're both from Europe. So you're aware of that now, correct?
Yes.
So these two young kids had gone to college in Chicago, and a friend of mine said, "Would you have dinner with them and talk to them?" And it just so happened I had met the head of production for Roger's company at a party, and he'd give me his number. So I literally called the guy from the table and said, "I'm going to send over these two terrific filmmakers." I hadn't seen anything they'd shot, but I heard they were good. But they're going to work for free, is what I told, this person. And these two young guys were like, "What do you mean we're going to work for free?" I said, "Now look, you get your second unit reel together."
Called an internship, but go ahead. It wasn't probably invented.
Exactly. And then I remember the production manager complaining to me, saying everything they shot was too good. It was so much better than the movies that Roger was making that they're, but I don't believe that at all. But do you want to show Jennifer who those guys were? Not their names, but the movies they were associated with?
Not the Godfather movies.
No.
Hold on, that came in from somewhere else. Someone else is trying to talk.
Oh, okay, we know who that is. All right, I'm just going to tell you one guy. So listen, when I had this
I was just getting mafia, so I don't know if anything dealing with the mafia.
no.
What's his
No,
name?
but we'll get huh?
What's the big guy's name? That has a voice.
A Brando.
Brando, he's here.
The guy with the broids. No, Marlon, if Marlon wants to talk, he can. That's fine. But this was no the first I said to these guys over lunch, over dinner, look, when you win your Oscar, don't forget to thank me, because I was getting them this job, right, with Roger. And they both went, yes, Rich, of course we'll thank you. The first one was,
They work with Ron Howard or ET or anything like
well,
that.
Ron Howard also did a movie with Roger, his first movie, And Rance Howard's in it. We've interviewed Rance. Rance is our old friend from Limit Up. Anyway, the two guys, one shot Schindler's List.
I'm running out on that. Okay.
And all of Spielberg's movies since. The other one shot Avatar. So that's Mauro Fiore and Janusz Kaminski. Both of these guys promised to thank me at Oscar time, and they both won Oscars. And they both got, when they got to the point of thanking people, they went, I'd like to thank everyone who helped me get to this podium today. So I'm in there somewhere. Yeah. Anyway, I forgot to brag about that, Roger.
That is really, really cool considering what they've done.
I wish I could take credit for it, but all I did was get them a job. And Roger gave it to them. So I just think it's kind of funny. You did start everybody. All right, so.
You're like 6 degrees of Roger, not Kevin.
So now does Marlon want to stop by and elbow Roger out of the chair? Is that what's going on?
No, they're just fighting over what movies were better. I don't know. I think it has to do with celebrating Francis Coppola.
All right, so let me ask Luana. There's a friend of hers who's very close to Francis, who's there over there on the flip side, a woman. Is that somebody that wants to come through, or is that not the right time yet?
Is she the one that recently passed?
Yes.
Okay. She says she'll come through. I don't know who she is.
Okay,
yeah.
That's very good. I appreciate maybe that.
Maybe all of those things that were coming in were probably trying to get me.
Well, maybe. That's why I said Luana has two close friends who passed over.
I wanted Roger to go first to open up.
Very good. And thank you, Roger. I apologize for booting you out of our chair.
Oh, but he's with our other buddy, Chuck.
Charles Grodin.
Yeah.
Whose name came up today. I was talking to a friend of his, and he wrote to me, 82-year-old movie producer, theater director, producer, wrote and said, I miss Charles Grodin.
We all do, don't we?
We all do, but I said, I get a chance to talk to him pretty often. Chuck, anything you want to say?
I'm being tortured by your other friend from Twister.
Bill Paxton.
Yes, he goes, if you can't remember my name, you're not going, because I've been saying to my girlfriends, we're going to go to Ojai. He goes, you can't go to Ojai. You can't remember my name. And I know that they block me. I know that they're being mean about it. But go ahead. Sorry.
So, Billy, I see that your son is in the sequel to your movie, Twister. What do you think about that?
He says it's perfect. He at least knows what to do. And he says that... it should be like the Halloween movies that they have, scary or whatever. They should make it.
Well, I saw the trailer for Twister 2, whatever it is, Twisters. It looks pretty good, actually. It looks pretty thrilling. They did a heck of a job. So I'm going to ask for this friend of Luana's to come forward. Her first name is Eleanor. Do you know who that is?
No.
Okay. And Eleanor... can we chat with you for a little bit? What's your impression or what we're doing? What do you think about what we're doing here?
Unique.
Very good.
Unique.
And who was there to greet you when you crossed over?
Hold on. Was she very religious? She wasn't very religious, correct?
Not that I'm aware of, but she was a very spiritual person.
Yes. Okay.
Like maybe said, more Zen Buddhist.
Yeah, she said God greeted her, but she's laughing about it. So that's why I was trying to figure out what she was saying. So if Zen Buddhist, that makes sense because she's making fun of the other. Never mind. Just erase all that. Hold on. Her teacher.
Her teacher. Okay, very good. And so what was your impression of crossing over or being over there? Was it what you expected or was it new, different?
Way easier than she thought.
Way what?
Way easier because of what she studied. It felt like just a crisp, clean, just energy.
Crossing over,
yeah.
And go ahead.
It was much more beautiful than she could have imagined.
And when you say that, are there visuals associated with that beauty or people or what do you mean?
She said, think of a rainbow and the prisms of light. Imagine that magnified by 100,000 times. Like just the colors of different, beings of light, different like places, different. And mind you, it's in your consciousness. Like, so she's showing it's very com it's complicated. So when you hold on, show me again. I have to calm my own brain down to even get the information, which is challenging. Give me a second. It's the colors and times 100,000 different colors, and think of the vibrations of each color and times that by 100,000 times. And that each one has a frequency of love. So, oh, it's so interesting. So, like, for me, pink and gold carry, that's just how I think of sending healing or sending
Feeling light,
love.
yeah, love.
And I do feel that as a free, I do feel that as a frequent, I do feel that as a frequency. But I never thought of it as, when she showed me all the prisms of light, all the prisms, like everything's energy. She's like, it's simple math, if you think about it. Everything's energy. Everything has a passcode or a frequency. You have a
Sure,
path.
frequency, yeah. Light is frequency and colors for sound, everything's frequency.
So if you wanted to match a high, like it's so interesting the way she's showing me. Like, how those locks where you have to put your thumbprint on and it opens up or whatever? If you put your thumbprint on wanting a certain vibration to match that frequency, you have to match it with your own frequency, right? Or you try to match it with your own frequency.
Yeah.
Stay with me, Richard.
No, I'm there. I'm there.
She's trying to say she had a great transition to the other side. It
No.
was swift. There was no, because of the way she believed here, the way she believed here, she was able to have no fear going over there.
And at what point did Luana show up?
Before I left.
Before you left. Okay. And what was that like? I mean, did you see her as a younger person or?
I saw her in her 20s.
In her 20s, when you guys met, is that correct?
Yeah, 30, like 20, 30, yeah.
Yeah, because I know you guys were
I don't know
friends.
this. I don't know
Oh, you
this.
don't know it is, but I will tell you. And
Only Eleanor I know of is Eleanor Roosevelt.
well, instead of getting into the idea of naming people, and I know, of course, there's some people who know me well who know what this is immediately. But other ones will not. And my point is, it's not so much of, I don't want to be invasive in any way about asking people questions about their journey, because it can be invasive for people that are on the planet who are thinking, like we talk to Bill Paxton all the time, Bill doesn't care. He's happy. He's chided me and chastised me before, like, get over it.
Eleanor says that the more people know how swift it is or how energetically your body might be doing something different, like it might show pain, it might show that it's breaking down. But she said, your spirit just swoosh, like she's just shown me a beautiful way of departing from these clothes and going into that. And she says it's not an invasive. She loves the fact that we have a forum, even if she didn't understand it at first, but Lana's clued her in, that we have a forum where people get to learn what it's like to die or what it's like from the best. I'm trying to give the best interpretation that I can
Sure.
about that.
About the transition. I mean, your mother said it so succinctly because she said to us, you showed me how what the process, and I had no idea it was more beautiful than the description. And to hear that from your mom, I mean, I didn't know your mom felt that way,
I didn't know she was reading your books.
So, but I mean, and then from to hear this from my friend Eleanor, who I knew through Luana, and Luana and her were pals, and they worked together many, many years ago.
I know that Hot Lips, you gave her chocolates or something with chocolates with Eleanor too.
Oh, well, that you know, I'm not aware of that, but that's very cool. I mean, I saw her maybe a year or so ago, and we emailed. That was pretty much our relationship. And I, for a long time, I've been mentioning this stuff, and I knew that she was a Zen Buddhist. And so, you know, Buddhism doesn't really believe or doesn't work on the idea that people exist after they cross over. They go in, you know, there's a theory about it going into a light, et cetera, et cetera. But there is the idea of reincarnation and going and energy, et cetera. So it's in the ballpark. But what we're talking about here is physically, you're shaking your head, no, but physically, her just, friend Luana's there to greet her, which is not what you see.
I know. She says it's all language. It's just a different, like, it's a ball of light. Luana was a light.
Yeah.
She said it was Luana. So what does that make it? You know?
That's right. So who were you surprised to see, if you've been surprised to see anybody over there?
She says her mother.
Okay. That makes sense.
She had, I don't know. She showed me the Luana with her mom and how they might have had different.
Oh, okay. I don't know if you're aware of that, but yeah, the Luana and her mother were.
Yeah. So she's sharing with me. It was very similar. So.
Okay. So like a combative, but you know, they were coming out of the '50s and the '60s and.
Yeah, it didn't end well, she said. Like.
I'm sorry. And what?
Their relationship feels like it didn't end well. Or
didn't end
it,
well. Okay. I don't know. But still, I mean, I
don't know who we're talking to other than Eleanor.
That's right. But that idea of when you meet somebody that you didn't, let's say you hadn't resolved something with, it is a surprise.
And her mom came through with nothing but love. And she understood the whole process within nanoseconds, she says, of why they did what they did here.
Wow. That's beautiful.
Made her a better mother, made her a better nurturer, and made her, you know, there was a lot, it felt like. I don't know.
Very interesting. And so right after you passed, I know I was driving through Westwood, and it was like I had a vibe or a sensation of you.
You put me in the car because you looked over and you saw something, like either a place that you guys ate at, or you guys, like, she says that she was right there with you and she made sure that you looked. She's like, that's, oh, she was helping me, like, so when I was talking about my client before, about the whole, it was such a cool thing where I saw how you become, anyway, how they merged their energy. And so she's showing me the same thing that she was with you. And she's like, hey, look at where we used to hang out, or look at where we went and had lunch or whatever it was, dinner. She said that she made sure that you knew how loved you are by her. And I don't know.
Well, that's sweet to say. You know what it was? I was driving through UCLA and I heard her voice saying to me, you know, this is, hey, I went here and this is where I met Luana. And I forgot, you know, that she had gone there, you know, as a young person. And she worked with Roger as well. So that's unusual. Like, you know, here we are, we can have this conversation. I mean, you know, but Eleanor, please tell us what you wanna, your observations, because you were quite an artist in your own right. I really admired your talent and your ability to tell stories. Tell us what you would like to impart from your experience to people tuning in who are, you know, struggling with their own losses.
Create your own stories of happy endings. Don't give up on the loss, or don't give up on the news or the betrayal or the lack of love. The only thing that goes with you is the love within you.
So when you say that, when you don't give up on the betrayal, you mean if somebody betrayed you in your lifetime?
Don't give up on getting over the betrayal, or let me figure it out with what she said. Hold on.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Just stop leaving your bodies trying to find something better. Your body, your heart, your soul holds all the keys to your happiness.
You mean like taking drugs or or
Not even that. She's just saying everyone's looking for, like, she's showing me coffee or drinking coffee or drinking or whatever it is. Like, she's like, just sit with yourself, love yourself, be kind to yourself. You're all that you have at the end of the day. You know, stop worrying about things that always end up okay. It always ends up okay. Sorry about that.
No, it always ends up okay. That's really important for people to hear. 'Cause we're all struggling with stuff and we all, we hear that.
Believe what you want to believe and stop thinking that someone else knows better than your own heart. Because a lot of times we get dragged around by thinking that they know better than what we know, or that we should be doing what they're doing. No one should be doing anything but what they should be doing.
Okay, very good. So, Luana, just talk to us a little bit about your experience, because this is a friend of yours who's now crossing over. And so, what was it like for you to be there, or I don't know, projecting? Were you seeing her as a young person as well, or?
She just showed me putting a flower in her like ear. Like they were wearing all white, both of them. And she was just saying, like Luana said, it was an honor to be there. Like it's an honor when you get to give love when someone crosses over. You don't just get to show up. It has to be like, I don't know what this is interesting because I've never heard this before. You get to earn the right to show up to somebody that's crossed over. You don't just get to show up.
Wow.
Yeah. And I earned the right. I had the love. You have to have the love. It's very interesting. Huh.
Eleanor used to mention this tree that you were particularly fond of, and when we exchanged emails and Christmas cards and stuff like that, she would sometimes send me a picture of this red maple that they have outside their house.
That red maple held all the secrets for the last, 150 years, it feels like.
Wow. Sure, that home, it's an old day. They have an old home. They have a very old home. Okay, and Eleanor, anybody on the planet you want to send a message to?
Is her husband still here?
Husband's still here, yeah.
She's like, I want to tell my husband. Hold on.
Please.
I have no idea.
That's you have no idea, but what she just keep it in those terms. She wants to tell her husband what?
I'm okay, and that he did the right thing by letting me go. Says he's struggling with it, and that he needs to know that I am perfect, I am great, and that the last week I wasn't in my body.
Well.
Means, but she says he's having a hard time because he feels like he let her go too quickly, or he let her go, or he should have let her go before, or something like
Or
that.
whatever, it's not setting right. And I know you had children, so is there anything for your children that you want to say or?
They need to get over feeling like they didn't spend enough time with me. They have very busy lives. Believe me, I'll be haunting them for the rest of theirs.
That's great. I know you have grandkids too.
One of them's writing a script about her, it feels like.
Sorry?
One of them's writing a script about her.
Oh,
It
one of them's
feels
writing a script about her. That's adorable. That's really wonderful. That's great.
like diving in or digging in. Yeah.
I know, listen, I don't want to, I'm not going to upset any carts here, but you did have a son who had crossed over a while ago. And I'm just curious how he's doing and if you guys have had a reunion or
Many,
many.
many.
He
Hold
said, I remember we talked about this once and you had a dream and he said to you, be bold or grow old. You heard him say that to you in a dream. You thought it was a dream. And I thought, wow, that's such a brilliant.
That's amazing. And she lived her life like that. Be bold by, she said she was already a little bit out there, though.
Okay.
I don't
All
know.
right. Luana, I want you to redirect this thing. I keep getting the message from Luana just to just move on, get on to the next topic. Who else do you want to bring forward?
I'm gonna have to go soon. Sorry
Oh, you
about
have to
that.
go. Oh my gosh, we've been chatting away. All right. Well, Lou, is there anybody else? Just let's let Chuck or Bill Paxton have a word in there because they showed up.
I'm sorry, Bill. Feels like I was Mormon and everything back then. Like, how could you be mean to me?
God, did you not see Big Love? I mean, come on.
Oh my God, I forgot about that. That wasn't even what I was thinking of. I was thinking of him in the 18th century
Oh,
as a
that's
Mormon.
right. In the 18th century, he said that he was a
Like,
Mormon
how
in
could you
a
do
previous
this?
lifetime.
Like,
Oh,
you need
that's
to,
funny.
I'm like, I need to write it down. I'm like, I'm sorry, you do this as a joke. Oh, hold on. Sorry, Kobe Bryant just came in. And I just wanted to make sure. I'm like, what? What? And he's like, no, I'm just looking. I pick whatever.
Kobe, you're always welcome, but if it's okay if you just want to stop by to give us a thumbs up.
To say hi. He was just wanting to say hi.
So
He just said
cool.
thank you because I helped his family. He just said thank you. Okay.
Kobe, I got a question for you. Can we talk about you a little bit when we do our contact in the desert talk? I mean, it's not live or it's not on the air.
Absolutely.
Okay, very good, because I just thought that would be an interesting thing for the audience.
All signed NDAs from over here.
Very good. Okay, Charles Grodin, come on. When is that movie coming out that they're gonna make a movie? They made a movie about you. I'm in it. It's a documentary.
To happen, but now something held it up. Something held it up because of the rights of the footage or something. So
Oh, can we help solve that?
it's getting solved, he says.
He's getting solved. Okay.
He'll know by June.
By June. And should we fly to New York and have a party and a premiere?
You could have it wherever you want, Richard. But
It,
you should go to New York. Take your kid. I think your daughter needs to be in New York too.
yeah, I know. It would be lovely. All
Yeah.
right.
Give me one second. There was something else that was being said. I just need to figure out what it
Please.
was. Hold on. I'm like, so what is it that you guys want to impart? Like, what's the bigger thing, right? And it was that you don't really have to know the person. I don't know who Eleanor is, right? They're
Yeah.
like, you don't know the person, but you can still get information. We're not going to give you anything that's going to harm yourself. Like, you have to go through that. No one's going to tell you to hurt yourself. No one, that's a whole different,
Yeah.
but it's also interpretation. So the interpretation that comes through, give, like, you've taught me, Richard, not to judge it. You've made me a better medium indirectly by the work that we do, because I've learned, and like, because it ends up happening. We end up talking to somebody over there, and then I end up talking to their family. It happens over and
Well,
over.
look, I mean, I'm so glad we did it this way because I'm not going to talk about who this person is because that's not important. What's important is that everything you said, I'm aware of, and I know it's exactly accurate in terms of who this person is or was and their journey. And it was wonderful to hear it sort of from their lips, and it's not like you can't have a colored of whether it was Eleanor Roosevelt or not. Let's put it that way. But that being said, Jennifer, you have this amazing gift, and I like to call you my cell phone. It's like you can dial people up, and even if they're like in a crowded restaurant and you can barely hear what they're saying, and you're doing your best to interpret, like they're shouting, or Bill Paxton, you're not going to Ojai, whatever it is. It's so wonderful to even consider for a moment that you might be able to talk to your friends who are off stage and having adventures, clearly. Not
It was
playing the violin or playing the harp on a cloud. They're having a blast.
very sweet. It was very sweet that I talked to Sarah, this client who loves our podcast. It's very sweet that I talked to her dad, Henry, who comes in this big personality. And then to hear about her dog, who's a cat now, like
That's so funny.
it's ever, but the way I'm like, well, that makes sense. You merge your energy. I mean, and the dog being like, I hated being a dog. I hate the way dogs smell. And the dog was just like that. Like, it was so happy to be a cat. Like, there is a lot of things. Like, Think about, I mean, it's not like dogs can get sex changes or cat, like it's not, like if you think about, I mean, that's a whole different book of worms, but I'm just saying
Well, are you
people.
saying the cat was alive and the dog came into the cat while the cat was already alive, or came
No,
back as
no,
a cat?
no. The dog became the cat, like the dog reincarnated as a cat.
It came back as a cat. Yeah, no, I think that's what we've heard from higher up, all the other animals. And you know, what they say is they aren't done with you. You know, they know your frequency and they find you. And so
All
it
the time.
totally makes sense. And I've heard people say, oh my gosh, you know, I had a dog and now here it is 20 years later, this other dog is the same dog, you know, or whatever. So in this case, hilarious. There's a movie in there. I think the movie Soul had a little bit of that. Didn't she like pop in? They changed personalities there and it was like, argh. Anyway.
Right.
Jennifer, you are so kind and generous and we love you and I really appreciate us doing this podcast. And for those people who are out there in the hinterland, come on down to Contact in the Desert where Jennifer and I are going to
Yes,
be
we're
live.
gonna. Okay, so how I work is you guys see me with my iPad. I have names. I have to work with names. So we're gonna have names in a, you know, in a basket, and I'm gonna be pulling names, and we're going to go through the process of how we work. And you get to ask a question of who it is that you want to talk to,
Whatever you want to.
what it is that you want to know. It could be medical stuff, it could be your counsel with Rich. We are going to do it that way. This is the best way that you can see us work together in this
Live.
life.
And hopefully that'll turn into like venues all over the world, stadiums.
Did you know that I have seen things in my dreams for the last 3 years of having like arenas where we meditate, but it's with music. So there's a sound, like there's music that plays where we go into meditate, where people go into meditations, and how powerful that is as a collective.
What's the
Everyone,
music sound like, by the way?
no, I didn't, I
Is
don't
it
know the,
me playing the piano?
I doubt that, Richard.
But I'm just wondering, should I bring music to our thing, our talk? Maybe I should. Maybe I
Maybe
should.
we should have meditation. Do the meditation that you talked about.
Yeah, we
Because
can do that.
all that, like, why not? Our biggest, I feel, what we do for everyone, what we're trying to do is get everyone to know they can be connected to their loved ones, right?
Right.
And so I think that we could do that with a group of people. I think we could take them into that and have them meet their loved ones.
I
And
think it'd be lovely. It'd be worth the effort. Let's put it that way.
yeah, so come see us. We're in the Palm Desert. Come on,
Come
grab
in.
it.
June 1st, Saturday, 10:30, the press of, no, Independence Room, I think. Whatever. You'll see it. Contactinthedesert.com. I'll put it underneath the thing here.
Okay.
All right, we love you, Jennifer. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. This has been Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jenniferschaffer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on Amazon Prime.